Hello. Welcome to Australian Video Film Articulation Institute, Basic Articulation Course on Video Cassette. I'm Tony Toothache, and I'm your film articulation teacher. Here is the English alphabet. Each letter comes with a sound, and some letters come with multiple sounds. These sounds are called phonemes. The International Phonetic Alphabet organizes these sounds by where it is produced in the throat and mouth and how it is shaped. This allows everyone around the world to combine these phonemes into an idea to convey to someone else who speaks the same language.
Whoa, hang on there. These phonemes are useless if you want to convey something to someone that doesn't speak the same language as you. Allow me to show you.
Well, let's translate the Russian word for mouth using only its phonemes. This character has the equivalent phoneme to the English r, while this one sounds like o, and this is just t. Altogether, this sounds like rot. But in English, rot doesn't mean mouth, it means something completely different. For example, we use rot for something like, I hope you run in hell. Now turn to the person next to you and say, I hope you run in hell, asshole.
I hope you run in hell, asshole. And now, for the second lesson, let's learn about double articulation, which was first introduced by the French linguist André Martinet. Let's give him a call. I'm just kidding. He's dead. Not to worry. He is still alive in his essay, Double Articulation as a Criterion for Linguisticity.
En latin et en grec, des cas, chose que les Français ne connaissent pas et qu'il faut bien expliquer.
That was boring.
Anyway, what he meant to say was that the first articulation of language is your ability to correctly select and arrange words into meaningful sentences, while the second articulation of language is the stringing of sounds, otherwise known as the phonemes, into meaningful words, otherwise known as monemes. Unlike phonemes, words come with an already prescribed meaning to them. However, just as phonemes exist in the alphabet, words come from a catalogue called the dictionary. Therefore, someone just can't create a new word to express a new idea. Sentences excluding idioms such as break a leg for good luck allow the speaker to express their own idea in the form of a string of correctly arranged words.
Well, if you really were to see how little repetition there is, you can, let's say, take a book or a newspaper or a library for that matter, and search for repetitions of phrases or sentences and so on. They occur, but rarely so.
Martinet argues that a language cannot exist without having both of these articulations. But in his 1959 essay on linguistic aspects of translation, the Russian linguist Roman Jacobson, well, he says that every sentence is more or less translatable. And a sentence belongs to a language if that sentence can be translated. Wow, that was great. Oh, hi, I didn't see you there. My friend and I just saw a silent movie at the cinemas. You know, what did you think about it?
Onestamente, ho davvero odiato il film.
I don't know what he said. I don't speak the same language as him. But, wait, you know what I was wondering? How could we both understand a silent movie if we don't speak the same language? Does that mean...
Yes, it is.
Film is a universal language. But why? Well, the French film theorist, Christian Metz, well, he said that there is nothing in the cinematographic language that is equivalent to the second articulation of language.
And that was said on the 61st page of the 1974 Oxford University Press English translation of Christian Metz's book Film Language. But it was on the 64th page he explains why that makes film universal.
Why is it that everyone can engage in a film? I mean, what is it that everyone is able to recognize in a movie? And how?
Narrative. 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 Yes.
Well, let's think about it. I mean, what is the most obvious thing that distinguishes narratives from reality? Well, it's gotta be, it has a beginning and it has an ending. It's its own closed sequence. It's its own dimension of time. But narratives exist to be experienced by us in the real world, in our dimension of time.
If we look at an image, we don't see time. An image represents a space within space. There isn't no time because the image will continue to be an image indefinitely. While a slideshow of these images demonstrates time as each image is replaced by the next. This is a description of the space because it represents space within time. It is the narrative that represents time within time. Any movement through the space indicates the passing of time, and therefore, there is a time of the thing told and the time of the telling. But if narrative is being told, it has to be told by someone or something, even if the author or narrator is the film itself. This is what Metz calls the grand image maker. And so, well, the existence of an author presupposes that the narrative is not reality, as the listener or spectator is not present at the time of the narrative or at the place of the narrative. A narrative can be realistic, but realism is not reality.
And finally, that unreal thing that the narrative is trying to depict is just a closed sequence of events.
Whose vehicle is articulated language?
The basic unit for articulated language? Yeah, it's the word. Fade.
Last time on Australian Video Film Articulation Institute Basic Articulation Course on Video Cassette.
Narrative.
It's its own closed sequence.
Dimension of time. Dimension of time. Time.
Whose vehicle is articulated language?
It's the word.
It's the word.
But wait. Wait. If the vehicle for narrative is articulated language, and the basic unit for articulated language is the word, then what is the basic unit for film narrative? Didn't Christian Metz just say that film doesn't have an equivalent to the second articulation, and so it doesn't have words? Can you work out what Christian Metz thinks the basic unit for film narrative is? Pause your VCR and discuss in groups.
What did you answer? What? No, I have no idea what you said. You probably didn't even say anything. According to Mr. Metz, the basic unit for film language is the image.
And the image corresponds to one or more sentences, as a sequence of images is a complex segment of discourse. Unlike written sentences, you cannot review previous sentences when they are spoken, because it occurs over real time, just as a film does. Therefore, the film shot is a kind of equivalent to the spoken sentence, or as Metz calls it, a completed assertive statement.
And so, without this second articulation and prescribed meaning to any codes or signs, film does not have a pre-existing language system, which Ferdinand de Saussure said was the lang.
People believe
they could understand the film because of its syntax, whereas one understands the syntax because one has understood, and only because one has understood, the film.
Instead, the film builds and establishes its own language system. And throughout the film, the audience adopts to intelligibly read the entirety of the film. And this idea is much deeper than it initially comes across. I mean, just as any human language has evolved out of its millions of proto-languages, variations, meanings, abbreviations, translations, misinterpretations, and mispronunciations, to arrive at a single language over a span of almost 2 million years, film is able to do all that in just 90 minutes.
Whoa. Alright. Christian Metz, hold your horses. Something doesn't add up here. I'm just thinking, okay, look, let me show you. Let's watch a scene or just a sequence of shots from the 2010 masterpiece, Kick-Ass.
I never play.
Oh, really?
Did you see how many shots were just used just then? I mean, that was 7 shots just to describe that. Would it not make sense that the entire action is just its own sentence? And if an entire action constitutes its own sentence, what does that make each shot? See you next time.
Welcome back. Another French film theorist called Jean Mitry argues in his book, The Aesthetics and Psychology of the Cinema, that cinema appears to be a new form of ideographic writing, where the image plays the part of both speech and word.
The verbal image is what Joseph Vendry has defined as the psychic unity which precedes the word, which is formed by the superimposing or association of 4 images. Oral, auditory, visual, and manual. However, whilst this verbal image is a collection of ideas, the word that we choose to convey those ideas is never sufficient. For example, if I were to say the word pizza, you will hear pizza, but the word pizza does not have pineapple on it. To you, the word pizza will invoke a collection of potential images that both have and do not have pineapple on it. It is only in the sentence where the word is preceded or followed by other words that the signified pizza is given its properties and context. That is, at least in the English language. The film image is almost exactly the verbal image, as it is formed with a collection of oral, auditory, visual, and manual images.
Therefore, for everyone to understand film, everyone in the world, it requires them to translate film into their own language, and even their own dialect. And there are a lot of languages in the world, and a lot of these languages can translate the verbal image as a collection of images into one single word.
Scene from the 1950 movie Young Man with a Horn. And while we're watching, let's translate it into a number of languages.
While watching a film, an audience member will only gather the aspects of the shot that are essential to the narrative. As with any narrative, and any sentence there is always a subject and a predicate. The subject of this scene is the boy, and the predicate of this scene is a compound of two verb phrases. The first is the boy approaching or walking up to the piano, and the second is the boy starting to play the piano. Therefore, in English, we would describe the scene as a boy walks up to a piano and starts to play it. The noun phrase in this sentence is a boy, and the two verb phrases are walks up to the piano and starts to play the piano. However, because film is a universal language, we can also describe this scene in other languages, such as French, or Greek, or Chinese, or even Esperanto.
In Esperanto, they just used four words to describe that entire scene. Well, in English, we would use 12 words. Why is that? Well, have you heard of morphological typology? No? Well, let's learn about it. Follow me.
Every human language can be placed somewhere on the analytic polysynthetic spectrum. Depending on where the language sits on the spectrum determines how agglutinative the language is and how much information a single word in that language can hold. The English language is closer to the analytic end of the spectrum because we are able to use multiple words to indicate a concept or message. In 1912, Edward Sapir documented that whilst in English the sentence "he cut off their necks with his knife" requires 8 words to say, the Native American Takalma language uses only a single word, when we're scouty. Many of the Native American languages would be polysynthetic because they are able to agglutinate morphemes together to convey a single word to convey a complex idea. Therefore, we can see in our previous example that the Esperanto language would be a synthetic language, as it only uses 4 words to describe the same statement that English can only describe in 12 words. And a native speaker of a polysynthetic language, like Takalma, would be able to translate this action into a single word where the meaning is agglutinated onto the base word. So what if the cinematographic language is neither analytic nor polysynthetic? What if film could convey an assertive statement over a number of words as well as in a single word? This is what I believe to be the analytic synthetic hybridity of the cinematographic language. Contrary to Christian Metz and Jean Mitry's theories, the film language does in fact have words, but not in the same Eurocentric perspective as Metz or Mitry. Before the introduction of the digital cinema camera of the late 90s, filmmakers had to be conservative with how much film they could use because it wasn't unlimited, which is why a lot of films before the late 90s would have to describe an entire action in one long take. The single shot is not enough to constitute one or more complete sentences. Because just as a sentence must include a subject and a verb phrase, the shot, according to Metz, would have to convey a complete verb phrase. However, as we observed in the shot sequence from Kick-Ass, occasionally the complete verb phrase might occur over several shots. Therefore, it should actually be the action performed by the subject or character that constitutes the completed assertive statement, while every shot that is used to describe the action is equivalent to the polysynthetic word. This permits the filmmaker the ability to convey an action in a number of different ways depending on how they want to tell their story.
The word periphrasis, or circumlocution, is something that a lot of young people do. If they don't know many words, they'll use a number of words to say something, instead of just using one word to say it, you know?
The word laconism, or elliptical construction, is defined as the sesquipedalian act of omitting contextually implied words in the contraction of a statement.
The word agglutination is the act of auto-translating a hyper-interconnected statement into a single polysyllabic word.
Film is both a written and oral language.
However, what determines what the spectator chooses to be the base word from the frame? And in what order does the spectator pick and choose other morphemes in the frame to agglutinate to that base word?
Find that out and more in the next installment of the Australian Video Film Articulation Institute Intermediate Articulation Course on Video Cassette.
Thank you. This concludes our basic articulation course. This has been the first course from the Australian Video Film Institute. I'm Tony Toothick, and I have been your film articulation teacher. If you're ready to continue, please eject this video cassette from your VCR, and please put in the Australian Video Film Articulation Institute Intermediate Articulation Course video cassette. I'll see you soon.